I will exalt you, my God, the King. I will praise your name forever and ever. Every day I will praise you and extol your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. His greatness no one can fathom. One generation commends your works to another. They tell of your mighty acts. They speak of the glorious splendor of your majesty. And I will meditate on your wonderful works. Amen.
Amen.
Come, let's rise and worship our King this morning. Father, we thank you this morning, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that we can enter into your presence, Lord, with thanksgiving and praise, Lord, Father. That we can worship you, Father, this morning, Lord. As we worship you, Lord, you be enthroned in our praises, Lord. We lift you high, Lord. We lift it high, Father, this morning. In Jesus' name we pray.
Thank you.
Bless us, Lord, that you would never leave us, Father.
Bless my God.
In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen.
Amen. Yeah.
Lord, to thank you, Lord. Not only in our good times, but even in our times, Lord, when we feel low, Lord. Help us, Lord, to look up to you, Lord, because it is you who have sustained us so far, Lord. It is you, who, Lord, who have given us this breath that we breathe. It's a gift from you, O Lord. We want to thank you, Lord, this morning, Lord. You are a God of restoration. You are a God who restores, O Lord. You are a God who blesses bountifully, Lord. We want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. And truly, we want to say, Lord, you are great. Great are you, Lord. And no one else in history, Lord, is like you, Lord. For truly you are a God, the maker of heaven and earth, Lord. And you have created everyone, Lord. You have created man, Lord, that we may bring praises, praise and worship unto you and your name alone, Lord. You deserve it all, Lord. You deserve the highest praise, Lord. You deserve, Lord. Lord, you deserve. We bring before you our praise and worship, O Lord, and that is what you desire from each and every one of us, Lord. This morning we come before you, Lord. We pour out, Lord, to you, Lord. Not only our praise, but our petitions we bring before you, our supplications we bring before you, our requests we bring before you. We can only ask of a Father, and it is a Father who blesses us, Lord. It is a Father who chooses to give it to us, Lord. How much we can sustain, how much we can contain, how much we can retain, Lord. Lord, thank you, Lord, that you are our Father. Thank you, Lord, that you are a good, good Father, Lord. In times that we desire this, when we wanted you the most, you were there, Lord. In times when we were low, Lord, you were there, Lord. In our loneliness, you were there, Lord. Lord, when we were down, Lord, you were there to lift us up, Lord. Yes. Oh, what a good Father we have, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Nothing can compare to Lord. Thank you for that unconditional love, Lord, that we need, O Lord, which no one can fill this heart, Lord, but only you alone, O Lord. Thank you for that love on the cross that you expressed for us, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you gave it freely, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you have accepted us, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you have embraced us, Lord. This morning we can only thank you, Lord, that it is you alone, Lord, who holds us. It is you alone, Lord, who lives in us. It is you alone who is by us, who stands by us. It is you alone, Lord. Our home front, Lord, we bring before you. Our ministry, we bring before you, Lord. And Lord, we say, great are you, Lord. Great are you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. In Jesus' name, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you. Good morning, church. We've had a blessed time of praise and worship this morning. And before we get into the word, let's knit our hearts together and pray. Lord, we just want to thank you for this wonderful day and time that you have given us, Lord Jesus. I want to give all praise, all glory and honor to your name, Lord. You're the name above every other name, Lord Jesus. And I pray, Lord, that as I speak your word today morning, Lord, that each word and every word that I utter would be guided by your Holy Spirit, Lord. And that as I speak, Lord, that each one of us listening, Lord, that you would stir up our hearts, Lord Jesus. And this would change us, Lord, and that as we go back, we would take at least one point back with us where we can change and implement in our lives, Lord Jesus. We submit this entire time into your hands, Lord. And all that we say and all that we do for your glory alone, Lord. In your mighty name I pray. Amen. Today, around the world, if we are reading the news, we know that the pandemic has been there. It has been there for so many months now. And all around the world, big-time pharmaceutical companies are collaborating with different scientists, different universities to come up with a vaccine that they can administer the people so that we could be away or we could be done with this pandemic. And it's not just pharmaceuticals or scientists, but we have even doctors who are working day and night trying out different permutations, combinations of medications that they can give to their patients day in and day out so that until the vaccine comes, they can combat this disease. Today, similarly in our lives, we have so many trials going on around us. Each one of us is going through a different situation. Each one of us is going through a different circumstance that may or may not be related to this pandemic. Many of us who are listening today, the pandemic has affected our lives in so many different ways that we can't even imagine. It's not something that we expected to hit. When the year started, none of us would have expected that this year, more than half of the year, would be in lockdown. And each one of us is going through a trial, going through a situation, trying to fight not just the pandemic but our daily issues in our daily lives. And you know what the good news for us believers who believe in Christ, what is that one good news? That we already have a vaccine from heaven. Not a medical vaccine, but a vaccine that God Himself has given us. And God has given us this vaccine, has provided us this vaccine for us to fight not just a pandemic, but every danger, every situation, every trial, and every circumstance that comes our way. Now, in fact, He tells us that in the end times, we need to keep a watch on what's happening around us. We need to keep an eye on what's going on, whether it be pandemics, whether it be plagues. God talks about all the different signs that we need to keep watch for in the end times. Therefore, we cannot say that life is going to be extremely great, it's going to be a bed of roses. There are trials that's going to come. Even though God has given us this vaccine, it's not like we are immune. We are going to face trial. God says there are going to be trials coming. There is going to be different circumstances that will come our way. But God says that He will take us victoriously through each and every step of ours. Now we must be wondering, what is this vaccine that I am talking about? Do we all have access to this vaccine? If we do have access, then how do we get a hold of this vaccine? Well, it's not as difficult as it seems. Each one of us today has an access to this vaccine. And each one of us can partake of this heavenly vaccine. And how do we do that? We do that by laying hold of all the promises that God has given us in the Bible. Today morning, the vaccine that I am talking about is based on the book of Psalms. It's basically three chapters that I'm going to be giving you a gist of, though we would focus on one particular chapter, that is Psalms 91. And the other two chapters that you all can refer to are Psalm 23 and Psalms 121. Psalms 91 gives us a brief gist on how we can actually activate this vaccine in our lives. So today morning, let's all of us look at it together. we will focus on 5 pointers on how we can activate this vaccine in our lives. Let's begin with the first one. The first one is dwell with God. Where do we see that? In Psalms 91 verse 1. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty, it says. Now God has a secret place of His own. The secret place is spoken of a lot in the book of Psalms. And it is a place that we all need to live in with God. We need to constantly keep ourselves in His presence, in close and intimate relationship with Him. Irrespective of the situation, irrespective of the environment around us, in spite of what that is going on around us, we need to maintain that intimate relationship with Him, where we can dwell with Him in that secret place. We need to give our priorities to Him. Our priorities should not be watching the TV, or how I can build my hobby, or how I can do this, how I can excel at work. Yes, that is also important. It's not like we are not to indulge in that. We are. We need to indulge in all of those things. But our priority needs always to be on God. God has to be our first priority in all that we do. And we need to spend time with Him daily. Now, if you read through different commentaries, or if you read through different Bible scholars, many Bible scholars interpret the secret dwelling place with the Ark of the Covenant and the Holy of Holies of the temple. Now, each one of us know that there was a small area inside, like right in the center of the temple, which was the Holy of Holies. No one was allowed to enter there. But when Jesus died on the cross, He broke down that curtain. And now each one of us has direct access to God. The second is through the Ark of the Covenant. They say the secret place of God is also within the Ark of the Covenant. How is that applicable? Now, if we look at the shape, or if we look at the design of the Ark of the Covenant, there are two cherubims, two angels that are guarding or sitting on top of the Ark of the Covenant, that is guarding the entire Ark. And inside the Ark, we know that there is the Ten Commandments, Manna, the staff of Aaron. But along with that, most important, God's glory resides in this Ark. And some historians and some archaeologists who are working on the Ark of the Covenant and all of the different biblical aspects, some of them say, I won't give you exact details, I won't go into details, you all can do the research on your own. Basically, what I want to say is that when Jesus died on the cross, the area where He was crucified, many historians say that at that point of time, the Ark of the Covenant was right below the cross. That means the Ark of the Covenant was buried right down in the same area where Jesus' cross stood when He was crucified. And they say that He was pierced and blood and water came out. So they say, and the earth shook. We all know that the earth shook at that time when Jesus died. And at that point in time, Jesus' blood flowed through the ground, through the crevices, through the rocks, and it went and fell upon the mercy seat of this Ark of the Covenant. Therefore, when you are residing in the secret place with God, and if that is the secret place with God, then when God sees you, He is not only protecting you, but He is also seeing the blood of Christ around you. So when you are residing in that secret place, you are not just with God, but you are also covered with the blood of Christ. But how do we get into the secret place? It's something very close and very intimate. And for that, we need to draw near to God. As we draw near to God, He will draw near to us. But for that, we need to take that first step ahead in drawing closer to Him. Therefore, when we dwell with God, when we draw closer to God, we can dwell in the secret place. When we dwell in the secret place, we are covered with the blood of Christ. And when God sees us, He sees His Son's blood around us. And He protects us. He takes care of us. We see that even in Exodus. We see when the Israelites, when the angel of death was passing, each one of them had to cover their house with the blood, signifying the blood of Christ in today's time. And when the angel passed, wherever they saw the blood, they did not touch the house, or they did not touch those people or the firstborn child in that house. It was the blood that protected them. Similarly, today, when we draw close to God, God protects us. That's why it's very important that we dwell with God and we cover ourselves daily in the blood of Christ when we pray with Him. You know, thinking of this blood of Christ and the way He protects us, it reminds me of a story. Around 2 or 3 years back, I had gone for a small vacation with a very close friend of mine and her family. And towards the end of this vacation, the vacation went quite well. But towards the end of this vacation, when we were staying in our hotel room, this hotel, we were in such a place where we were in the center of a very long passage. So our room was in the center of that long passage. And on one of the nights, the night before we could leave to come back home, at that night, there was a man who came in a very inebriated state. He was totally under the influence of alcohol and drugs. And he came in the middle of the night, so many people didn't see him coming. And he too was staying in the room right in front of us. And you know what happened? Both my friend and I, every morning before we would leave and in the night, we would always sit together and pray. And we would cover ourselves with the blood of Christ, and we would always recite Psalm 91 and 121, even in the morning before we left and in the night before we slept. That night too, we had our dinner together. Even her cousins were with us. We had our dinner. We came back to our room, and her mom, she and me, we sat, we prayed, and we recited Psalm 91 and 121. We went to sleep, only to awake at 4 in the morning when we heard huge things breaking outside our room. And her cousins were in the room next to us. And they called us on the telecom and said that there is a crazy man outside. Don't even by mistake open your doors. And we were very scared because we could hear the amount of sound that was coming from our room. As humans as we were, we got scared for a minute. But we just jumped out of our beds, all of us. In that fear, we just held our hands together and prayed that, Lord, we cover ourselves with your precious blood and nothing can touch us. And in the meantime, knowing how bad the state outside was, we were trying to get things in self-defense. So if something happened, we knew we could try and fight back. And this person was a really tall guy. He was a giant, like a figure when we saw him. And he broke the door of this friend's cousin of mine, and he tried to strangulate one of them in that state of what state he was. And we were terrified. Anyhow, the cousins managed to push him out. They were trying to contact the police, but they were not getting through. And anyhow, they managed to push him out of the door and stand guard on the door. And they immediately called us and said, see, this has happened. Please take care of the door. And we were all ladies. We didn't have that much of power where we could stand against that door. But in that fear, we just prayed. We said, Lord, it's not us, but you who protect us. And nothing can come against us. And they say, 1,000 shall fall at thy side, 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not touch thee. We saw it very clearly that day. That man attacked the room next to us. He attacked the room on the right and on the left. You know what? He attacked our room as well. He used a huge, huge pillar that was at the side. He broke or rooted the pillar out of the floor. Imagine how heavy that pillar was. And with that pillar, he tried to break the door. But the door just never broke. And you know what the different part about the story was? That he was so strong that the other two doors on our left and right of our cousins and the guest next to us were broken with just his leg. Our door never broke with the leg. He used that pillar to break our door, but that door still never broke. Why? Because our God was protecting us. Still today, when I talk about it, I really wonder how God protects us. And that door never broke till the end. He damaged floors, he damaged the ceiling, he damaged the hotel in so many different ways. His room was a total damage, but nothing happened to us. He couldn't even break our door with that pillar. Why? Because our God was protecting us. That because the power that Psalm 91 and 121 has, very often we just tend to neglect it. We just recite it for the sake of it, but we don't know the power that lies within that. And that day we were protected. When all of this was over, when they got hold of him, when they took him away, and when we came out, we were shocked at the sight of what we saw. Things outside us were just broken. Huge objects were in pieces. But that door of ours never broke. He couldn't even come anywhere near us or touch us. And we were protected. Today, we stand testifying of what God did for us that day in that hotel room. Coming back to our topic. Sometimes, as I said, we are humans. We get fearful. We get so busy with our jobs, with our families, with so many of our daily activities that we tend to lose our hunger for God. We tend to lose that zeal that we have for our God. But the more we start to dwell with God, the more we make it a habit to spend time with God, the more we will want to know about Him, the more we will want to learn about our God. And you will realize that not a single day can pass without you having God by your side. And as busy as we may be, we need to build that relationship with our God. And He will take care of us. No matter what the trial, no matter what the circumstance, God will carry us through it. And when we are under the shadow, we will know what His protection means, what His comfort means, what His care means, and even what His corrections mean. He can even correct us through all of these things because we are so intimate in relationship with Him and He loves us so much that He will even correct us through this entire process. But He will be with us always. Now this term, shadow of the Almighty, it's a term or it's an expression that denotes great nearness, closeness with someone. Now, if you're going with someone, if you're walking with someone, for that person's shadow to fall upon you, you need to be close with that person. Similarly, this term denotes nearness or closeness. And the Bible speaks about this shadow in four different ways. The first it speaks about is the shadow of the rock, which He speaks about it in the book of Isaiah. The shadow of the rock. Now why rock? Why does He talk about it with a rock? That because a rock is a huge, huge stone-like structure, you can say. And if you go to a hot country or if you go to a very hot place, you will know that when it is seriously hot, when the sun is beating on the ground and there's nothing around, the shade of that rock is very satisfying. Not just because of the shade, but the rock or the stone has a natural ability of natural coolness within itself. So even if the environment is hot, the rock has its own coolness which it sends out. Therefore, even in the hottest or the hottest of rays of the sun, this rock is like a shadow, providing coolness and reflecting coolness, communicating coolness and shadow and protection. Next is the shadow of the tree that is spoken about in the book of Songs of Solomon. Now why have they used this metaphor of a tree here? And not just a tree, Solomon talks about it in the form of an apple tree. Now why so? Because if you go to a forest or if you go to a place where there are a lot of trees, now all of these trees do not have sucker. If you go to a forest, all the forest trees will not provide you succor. They may provide us shade, they may provide us protection from the rays of the sun, but all of them may not be able to provide us the nutrients or the food that we need or the food that a human needs. So they can provide shelter but not refreshments or nutrients. Whereas if you go in all of these trees, in the midst of these woods and in the midst of the forest, The apple tree signifies refreshment. It gives you refreshment. It can give you a fruit that you can quench your thirst as well as your hunger. So it satisfies you from all the different angles, whether it be shadow, whether it be nourishment or nutrients. Similarly, is Christ in our lives. Whatever happens around us, we may find shelter in certain things, or we may find a sort of feeling of protection in some place. But the full solace or the full protection from all different elements that our body or our soul needs can be given only and only to Christ. None of this can actually supply, or none of this can actually quench our soul, our spiritual food, and all different angles. That's why it's related to a tree, and that's how Jesus is for us. He alone can supply all of our needs, and no man can ever do that. Next, it talks about the shadow of his wings. This is similar to a chicken gathering its chick. The wings denotes protection and warmth. And lastly, the shadow of his hand. This too denotes protection. Coming to the next point, you need to say of the Lord. Verse 2 says, I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in Him will I trust. The next way to get heaven's vaccine is by our mouth, or scientifically if you call it, it's by oral administration. Now, we might be wondering, why is the emphasis on saying of the Lord? If you read through the book of Proverbs, it speaks a lot on the power of words. It says that the power of words is so much that you can choose life or death just by the words that we speak. Therefore, it is doubly important that we speak the right words, not just to others, but also to ourselves, to our bodies, and to our minds. We all know the story of Jesus being in the wilderness and the devil tempting him. The devil tempted Jesus in the wilderness when he was hungry, he was fasting. But what does Jesus do? He declares the word of God. Everything that Satan said to him, he replied with the word of God, telling him, quoting the word of God to Satan. And through that, he resisted Satan, or he rebuked Satan. That is how important it is for us to read and memorize, as well as declare the word of God openly, boldly, and loudly. In fact, just I think 2 weeks ago, we were speaking to the Gideons during Sunday school and telling them the importance on how they need to declare the word of God, they need to memorize and read the word of God daily, as how important it's going to be for them through their entire life. Therefore, it's not important that we just speak, but we need to speak in a right way. It is important that we don't talk fear or doubt into ourselves or into the world. We need to speak positively. Now, with all that is going on around us, it's very easy to become negative, to hear the news, to hear media people speak about different situations. And it's very easy to get into the negative side of it. But God has told us, we need to not be discouraged, but we need to rejoice, especially in the last days, the Lord says. Rejoice all that is happening. Therefore, we need to speak the word of God positively. We should not let the environment around us play with our minds. Therefore, the words coming out from our mouth should be joy-filled words based upon the truth of God's word and not the facts reported by the media, because God has the power to change that. And God protects and takes care of His children. But like he says in Psalms, it is very important to say of the Lord, to declare of the Lord. Because just imagining something or thinking about it is not going to make a difference. Now, you can think in your mind that the Lord is my refuge, He is my fortress. But just imagining is not going to make that impact. You need to speak it out. You need to declare it from your mouth. Why is declaring so important? Because you're just speaking to your body. Your body listens. Your body generates an energy when you speak it out. all of us might have seen an army march, maybe in a movie, in a documentary, on National Geographic, or any of these places. We've all seen an army march, or we've seen people, a karate fight, or an army during war, or people during war, basically. Have you ever seen any of them absolutely silent, not doing anything, and just fighting with their enemy? Never. You see the army, before they even go to fight, they'll always shout battle cries or war cries, and not just say it like, okay, we have to go and win. No, they scream it, they shout it out. Why do they do that? Because that generates a source of energy within them. It generates a certain pace in their bodies. It generates a focus, a fierceness, a drive within them that, okay, we can do this, because they are declaring it boldly. And through that, it's not just that. You know what? When, if you read through the different historic books, sometimes people scream or people shout in battle cries because it also intimidates the enemy. We have seen that so much in the Bible itself. People have screamed or people have shouted. Even Jericho, the wall fell down because they screamed on the seventh day. Similarly for us, when we boldly declare the word of God, when we say it out loud, it generates an energy within us. It generates a focus, a fierceness within us. It gives us the strength that we need to get through the day. It gives us the strength to get through a situation or a circumstance or through sickness. Whatever it is, that word of God gives you the strength. Therefore, it's very important that we boldly say of the Lord that He is our refuge, our fortress. In Him we will always trust. It says the life you are living today is a direct result of the words you spoke yesterday. That's how important it is to speak the right words. The third is set your love upon Him. Verse 14 says, Psalms 91:14 says, because He has set His love upon me. Therefore, when the word therefore means that something happened before that, what happened before that? God says He set His love upon me. That is, we need to set our love upon Christ. And this is the third way of getting our vaccine. We need to set our love on God. God does not to be our dwelling place. He also needs to be the one we love, we adore, or we are in awe of. God always has to be our first love. Not in one particular aspect, but from all aspects, He needs to be our first love. And nothing or no power or nothing should precede the place of God in our lives. In Colossians also it says that if you put your love on things above and not on the things of the world. Many places in the Bible it says our focus needs to be above, not on the things of the world. We need to love things above, not the things on the earth. Even in Matthew it rightly says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all the things will be added unto you. So if God is our priority, if we set our love upon Him, our relationship with God will automatically develop. And once we are right with God, God will set things right in our life. We can love people. It's not bad things to love people or love your neighbor. God Himself says, love your neighbor. It's not bad to enjoy nice things or be affectionate to people. But whoever we love or whatever we love, God always has to be our first love. Therefore, this vaccine can work for us if we love God with all our heart, with all our mind, and with all our strength, putting Him first in our lives. And it is the place that He deserves. Now, the church at Ephesus, they had many good works. They did many good works. Revelation says they were faithful. They stood against evil. But Revelation also says, Jesus says in Revelation, I have this against you, that you left your first love. The church at Ephesus, they were doing good things. They were faithful. They were standing against evil, everything. But the most important part, they got it wrong. They lost that first love. Therefore, we need to have God as our first love. Whatever we may do at the side, we need to have God as our first love, and nothing should precede that. And when we do that, automatically our priorities will fall into place. If you look at David, David says, early will I seek you. He goes on to, if you read through that psalm where he speaks about, early will I seek you. He then goes on to say, how I was thirsty and I was in a dry land. But by seeking you early in the morning and by praising your name, my soul is blessed with marrow of fatness. That means he was healthy. He was deriving a strength to get through his day. We all knew David's life was not easy. He was constantly, people were running after him. His life was in danger. But look at what he says. I will seek you early. I will praise your name. And God restores blessings with marrow and fatness into his lives. We are humans. We definitely get tired, especially with the things going on right now. Life gets tiring sometimes. But when we love God, we need to show that in our actions as well. And when we say we love God and God is our first love, we will definitely see that in our actions. Therefore, when we say He's our first love, we are automatically going to spend time with God. We are going to enjoy spending time with God. We are going to be wanting to spend time with Him more, to get to know Him more deeply. Let me put it this way. All of us may have seen a couple newly in love. And many of you all who are elders, our parents, might have even experienced that phase in life. When you are truly in love with someone, you will never miss one opportunity to talk to that person. You would want to spend more time with them. You would probably even readjust your schedule. You would change certain things in your lifestyle just because the other person doesn't like it. You will make time for them. In fact, I know of some people who actually, whenever people who got up early, but they get up early now, just so they can talk to their better half, as they say. They adjust everything of their lives around that one person. And sometimes some of them, even before they rush off to work, they at least want that 5 or 10 minutes to speak to this person. And sometimes if they don't get it, their entire day goes haywire. They feel upset the whole day. Oh, I didn't get to speak to this person I love. Oh, I'm angry this didn't happen or that didn't happen. Now, if a human love can create that much of a sentiment in your day, imagine what a sentiment can create when your first love is God. So when your first love is God, whatever happens, you will make that 5 minutes extra in the morning just to spend time with Him. Because you know, if I don't spend my time with God, probably my day might not go the way I expected it to be, just like the lovers outside. Because your priority is God. You know that you need to set your priorities right so you can spend time with Him. And when you're spending time with Him, you're getting that strength, that joy to get through the entire day. And you're also conversing with Him through the entire day. That is how our first love needs to be. That is what the impact our first love in God can create in our life. You know, Romans chapter 8 says, "For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God." That is the amount of love that God has for each one of us. He says nothing can separate, whether above or beneath. That much God's love for us is. So how much commitment do we need to have to our God above? That is how important our love to God is. He has given us all His love. He even sent His Son down for us. That much He loves us. How much is our love for God? Is God our first love today? Is something we can ask ourselves. Coming to the fourth point is, know and use His name. Psalm 91:14 says, the second part of the word says, "Because He has known my name." There is power in the name of God. There is power in the name of Jesus. And each time we use that name, or each time we say that name, power and ability is released in that situation on our behalf by God. And it's very important that we know His names and we use that names in our situation. We need to rely on those names. Whether it be sickness, whether it be lack, It may be trouble, it may be a difficult circumstance at work, it may be your situation in your college, whatever it is, we need to use that name. Demons fear at that name and terror gets terrified by that name. Therefore, it is very essential that we use it. We have dominion through that name. And God wants us to overcome. Therefore, He's given us a name that we can use to overcome. Do we know that each and every situation or circumstance or trial that we face, whatever it may be, God has a name for each one of that. You can take that name and boldly declare His name in each and every situation, in each and every circumstance. In the book of Acts, there's a story of Peter and John. They were going up to the temple to pray, and as they were going, they saw a beggar sitting over there. A man, he was crippled, he couldn't walk, he was sitting and asking for alms. And even when Peter and John came, he looked at them and he asked them as well for alms. What do Peter and John tell him? In fact, this was a Sunday school song as well that I sang as a child. That silver and gold I don't have, but what I have, I can give you, Peter and John tell him. And what did they have? In the name of Jesus Christ, they say. They use that name of God. In the name of Jesus Christ, rise up and walk. He gets up and he goes walking, leaping, praising God. Silver and gold had no use for that man. But just the name of Jesus changed his situation. That is how important the name of God is. Therefore, firstly, we need to know the names of God. And once we know them, we need to use them in our daily lives. And the last one is, call on Him and pray. Verse 15 says, He shall call upon me and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. Prayer works. Prayers can work wonders. But for that, we first need to sit and pray. When we call on Him, He helps us. He answers us. Maybe not in a yes, it might be a no also. But that is for our best. But we need to call upon Him. Whatever may be the answer from Christ, we need to call upon Him. Calling on Him or praying does not only mean when our situations are bad or when we are going through our valley times or everything around us is bad. Like for currently the pandemic, like things around us don't seem very good, so we are praying. No, praying is not just limited to when things are going bad, but you need to also pray in joy. You also need to pray in thanksgiving. And that is something David did a lot. Even when things were bad, he praised God. But even when things were good, he thanked God. That I'm thanking you for this, I'm thanking you for that. He thanked God for the sun, the moon, the stars, for him waking up. So many different things. So it's not just limited to praying or our petitions, but it is also to thank God that He gave us what He gave. When we are faced with trouble, whom do we call upon? Do we rely on man or do we trust in God? It is difficult. Sometimes we get tensed in a situation. But we need to develop that habit of trusting in God, praying and calling on to His name, whatever our situations be. James says, confess your trespasses and pray for one another that you may be healed. The effective and fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. Now, what does this effective and fervent prayer mean? The dictionary says fervent means having or displaying a continuous passionate intensity. What do you mean by a continuous passionate? It's not just at this moment or at the next moment. It's a continuous tense. It is constantly happening. So it be good, it be bad, whatever it is, you need to constantly pray, call upon the name of God. If things are good, bless His name. Give Him thanks for that. That is, daily we need to pray and spend quality time with Him. Like I said, the time around us don't seem very good. But therefore, it is very essential that as individuals, as families and as a church, we come together and we pray, and our prayers can work wonders. There is a lot of power in our prayers when we pray from a genuine, humble heart. prayer is the answer for all the trouble that we face and for the heartaches of this world. There is a vaccine for us from heaven in the fifth point, and that vaccine is nothing but prayers, calling on His name. 2 Chronicles says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and heal their land. Therefore, if we seek Him genuinely, when we turn from our ways and we go down on our knees to Him, He will answer us. Whatever the world might be, whatever there is around us, whichever government holds power, our God has the ultimate power. Before I close, I would like to show you a small demonstration on the power or the importance of prayer. Like I said, we need to make God our first love in our life always, and He needs to be our priority. If He needs to be our priority, we need to keep the hindrances that come our way away from us. So I'll just show you a small demonstration on that. Here I have a glass which will represent our life. I have a candle which is burning. This candle will represent our prayers, our conversation, our daily talk with God. And I have water here which I have colored it just so that you all can see it clearly. This water will represent the Holy Spirit. So as this is our prayer, so when we pray repentance or when we pray in our lives that God take away the hindrances, when we really make Him our first love, give Him all the priority, daily have conversation with Him, and our life is surrounded by our prayers. If we slowly see and we keep this here, the prayers are constantly in our life. And if you see, slowly by steadily, you can see the water coming up. What does this represent? That when we are daily in conversation with God, when we are praying to God to take away that hindrances, He takes away those hindrances from us. Or rather, you can say, He burns away those hindrances from our life. He takes away the not so good things from our life. And as that goes away from us, we can see slowly but steadily the Holy Spirit starts filling our lives. And as the Holy Spirit starts filling into our lives, we automatically are going to do the will of God. Our conscience changes. Our life begins to change. And if you see, if I try to remove this, it doesn't come out so easily. Because when the Holy Spirit has filled our life, when God is the center of our life and is residing in us, that relationship automatically gets stronger, until and unless a strong force from outside comes to destroy it. Therefore, that's the importance of our prayers. And God listens to our prayers. He burns those hindrances away. But for that, we need to call on to Him. We need to talk to Him daily. And not just once, not just twice, but daily, God will fill our lives with His Holy Spirit and help us to get on with life. And a relationship, not just filling, but a strong relationship that cannot be touched or cannot be hindered. Therefore, from today, let us not just read or just recite daily Psalm 91, but let us understand the meaning and the depth that chapter has. Let us start putting that chapter into practice. Let us get vaccinated every day. Let's begin with these 5 pointers as a start. And as we continue to put things into practice in our lives, we will watch Heaven's vaccine work for us, for our families, and also for the people who are around us. I hope you are blessed and you have 1 point at least to take back and learn from. God bless. Stay safe.
Is applied to the door of my life. No power of darkness could ever withstand the force of the blood sacrifice. Though Satan will bring accusations, I let him know right where I stand. For now there is no condemnation. I'm under the blood of the Lamb.
I'm under the blood of the Lamb. the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you. And I pray that God's divine favor surround every one of you in Jesus' name. Amen.